Hey folks, to keep up with tradition, I've decided to do a post-LAN vlog for the CEVO Gfinity Season 9 Finals. Now, before the event started, I had done a pre-LAN vlog where I kind of had a heart-to-heart with the community about some things and talked about what the event meant to me. It's a pretty short video. I will put that in the description below if you'd like to check it out, because I might reference some things from it in this video that might confuse you, so I figured I'd just throw that out there right away. And also, just want to let you know, this vlog is going to be more of just personal stuff, you know, things from my perspective. I won't really talk too much about results and, you know, storylines as far as the actual competition goes. I do plan on doing some content separately from this vlog that'll tackle those topics, but this is just more of kind of a, you know, a personal vlog for me about the event and, you know, just going through it day to day. And it starts off with traveling there. So this was the first time I had ever left North America. I had left the country before when I went to Montreal a couple of years ago for an ESWC qualifier. So I'd been to Canada, but I had never been, you know, outside of NA to Europe or anything like that. So the transatlantic flight experience was certainly one that I had never had before. And I got that in there. And I left on a Tuesday afternoon before the event started from where I live, and I landed in London at like 8:30 in the morning on Wednesday, and then I had rehearsal that night at 7 o'clock at night. So what actually happened was, since I had so much time between when I landed and rehearsal, you know, I just kind of checked things out a little bit. I met up with Helium, aka Joey Cunningham, one of the casters for the event, as well as Kevin, who is one of the observers for CEVO, as well as had done the major and some different things like that. And we actually just hit up the subway and kind of checked some things out. This is actually my first time riding a subway before. I had been on some, like, I guess smaller ones that they have in airports and stuff like that, like the Atlanta airport, for example, or I think Dallas-Fort Worth has, like, the Skyrail system. I've been on a couple of things like that, but I had never been on an actual real underground subway before, so it's really neat just getting on the train and just kind of seeing the scenery of the city and the surrounding areas while just kind of riding from place to place. So that was kind of cool in itself, and basically we just kind of did some general touristy shit whenever we went through here. So basically just pissing people off that live in London as I walked around with my face behind the screen of my phone. This dude's just trying to jog. I'm busy taking pictures of shit I'll never look at again. But yeah, that's basically what we did. So got to see, you know, Big Ben, rode the London Eye, and just kind of walked around and enjoyed a little bit of London, or as much of it as we could in one afternoon. And so that's kind of how I kicked off the trip. Just forced myself to stay awake, make sure I didn't ruin my sleep schedule. That way I could just go to bed that night and be ready to go on Wednesday when the show started. And then, of course, later on that evening, we actually did have rehearsal where, you know, I got to meet up with some people I hadn't seen in a very long time. So meeting back up with the CEVO staff members again, like Pfeiffer and Matt Raza, known as Howard Dean Online, and Tasky Man or Will. So just some of like the CEVO staff admins, as well as some of the admins like Ferrari and Davis and some of these other guys, some of which I had never met before, some of which I had, but just catching up. Again, the last event I went to with these guys was, you know, way back in July of 2015, which is the last event I had actually ever done. So it's just really cool catching up with people. Same, you know, with Helium and Launders and Kevin, you know, some of the other casters that were there, people that I just don't get to see it very often. Again, I kind of talk about these LANs as almost like family reunions sometimes, especially if you don't go to events very often. It's just really cool to kind of, you know, have that community spirit and just being able to hang out with people that you talk to online all the time, or you see them all the time online, to be able to actually meet with them face to face is definitely a cool experience. Also met Metis for the first time, as well as Jackie for the first time. You know, I had known Metis online. We had some heart-to-hearts behind the scenes because we had, you know, some similar journeys, I guess, as far as, you know, not getting hired for very much. And now Metis has begun to blow up. But yeah, we had just, you know, talked behind the scenes. I think we had maybe casted a couple of regular season games online for CEVO, perhaps, throughout, you know, the past couple of years. But I never met him in person, so it was really cool to meet him. And then Jackie is someone I didn't really know much about. I know he does a lot of ESL stuff for the UK, among some other things. I think he was at Acer Predator Masters, and I think I had watched one online broadcast of him with DDK for Face It, just to kind of get a feel for who he was as a caster, because I knew I'd be working with him at some point. But meeting him was really cool. Really hilarious dude, really awesome guy. Same with Metis. Really cool meeting up with those two, and really great working with them, as I'll talk about later. met Richard Lewis for the first time at rehearsal. We had, of course, communicated online quite a lot. I think I was even on a couple episodes of his Trash Talk show that he had. But it's just kind of a different, you know, meeting people in person. And the dude is just awesome. You know, I don't know how he catches any shit. He's one of the nicest guys I've ever met. Just really, really cool dude. Really stand-up guy. And it was definitely awesome to meet up with him. Met with Thorne again. I had met with him once at one of those CEVO events earlier last year, but met up with him again. Again, really cool dude. Fun talking to him when I did get the chance to. Also met the Banks guy, the interviewer. I didn't really know much about him either before the event, but definitely, you know, a cool dude as well. Did a good job, I thought. So, yeah. Again, I mean, I don't think I really met anyone that, you know, wasn't just a stand-up guy. You know what I mean? Like, everyone seemed really, really cool, really genuine, really nice people. So that's always cool when you don't, you know, run into someone who has this super huge ego or who's a complete asshole or something like that that you're forced to work with anyway. There was none of that. Everyone was totally awesome, and it was really cool being there with all of them. I'm trying to think if I forgot anyone. I mean, I think I already mentioned Launders and Joey, so yeah. I mean, I think that pretty much hits everyone. Oh, yeah, also just meeting some of the Gfinity staff members behind the scenes. There was Michael Brown, who ran the entire show, basically. Really cool meeting up with him. Even just the people that were in makeup were really cool. You know, all the behind-the-scenes staff that were doing different production things or, you know, directing things. Hudge G was actually there as kind of a talent manager. He was kind of taking care of us, making sure that we were in place, making sure that we had what we needed, whether it was like water or a drink or going to grab us food if we didn't have time to grab it. Yeah, that dude, awesome guy. You know, even though he was like maybe used to more glorious work being a professional player back in the day in Counter-Strike Source for some different, you know, big UK teams, as well as I think a little bit in CSGO in the very beginning. You know, he was just excellent to all of us behind the scenes, just taking care of us and everything like that. So definitely huge shout out to that guy. You know, you probably won't even hear too much about him because he wasn't, I think he was on camera once. He did an interview with Puckett on one of the days, like when we had like a little bit of a delay when he filled some time, where he kind of talked about his old days in Counter-Strike and tried to compare it to the situation with some of the teams. So he was on camera once, but a lot of his stuff will go unnoticed. And yeah, he was definitely pretty awesome. And so we had our rehearsal where we just kind of did a quick run through of the show, you know, went through some graphics, went through kind of how, you know, the show would work and, you know, get used to the equipment, you know, just basic stuff. And I went straight to bed after that because I was wrecked. And then I knew I had the cast next day. So day one is where things actually really started popping off. And the first game that I actually casted was Zingatoss versus Selfless. And I casted this one with Metis. And it was a quick 2-0 series. Zingatoss actually crushed Selfless on Inferno and Mirage. Very one-sided scores, very one-sided game. In the cast, I felt super rusty and I was super nervous. I normally don't get nervous before broadcast, but this one I really was. And I talked about this a little bit in the pre-LAN vlog as well, that, you know, I knew that this event could kind of make or break me, so to speak. You know, I hadn't been to an event in a really long time. I kind of faded into irrelevancy, to be honest, since the last event I did back in July of last year. Yes, I'm constantly putting content out, like vlogs like this one, and I write some articles for Splice, and, you know, I do online broadcasting. But this was different. You know, this was me on a LAN stage with, you know, a much higher viewer count than what I would get casting online matches during the regular season. And so I knew that, like, I just had to kill it. And, like, I had done all the preparation I possibly could to do a good job. You know, I'd spent the last several months just grinding through demos and match VODs and stats and interviews and yada, yada, yada to just, you know, get my knowledge up about all these teams and players and how they like to play the game and how they approach the game and their trends and tendencies and all that good stuff. But at the end of the day, if you can't deliver all that information properly, you know, if you can't, you know, present everything that you had been researching in the proper way, then it really doesn't matter. Or if your casting just straight up sucks, then, you know, people aren't going to like you no matter how much work you did. And I felt like I didn't do really well this broadcast at all. Like, I felt hella rusty because I actually hadn't done any casting at all for a few weeks leading up to the event. And then, like I said, I haven't casted LAN in a while. So I was, like, really jittery. I mean, maybe you guys noticed it in this broadcast that I was just, like, super nervous. I felt all over the place. And I just felt like I didn't do a great job. And then also, casting blowouts is a challenge in itself. So you combine that with everything, I thought, oh, man, that didn't go well. Metis was kind of there to, like, reassure me that everything was fine. And, you know, the other staff members said, yeah, it was good. I mean, it's a blowout match, not much you can really do type deal. So it was really cool that people were always, like, reassuring and supportive, especially whenever I wasn't feeling so hot. And then I went straight into the next game, feeling kind of out of it, like I hadn't really done what I needed to do. And this was the Optic versus Hellraisers game, which was when all three maps, and Optic actually did take the first map on Cobble, and then I think it was Hellraisers just kind of beat them on Cache and Overpass pretty one-sided fashion. This was my first cast with Jackie, so I really didn't know what to expect, so I'd never worked with this guy before. And while I knew that he was good, because I had heard some of his stuff, I didn't know how we would actually mash up together, but this dude is excellent. I know Metis is another guy that's excellent, that has a lot of talent, but he's already kind of begun to get some stuff. Like, you know, he did DreamHack Malmu, he did some stuff at the end of the year, I think, for DreamHack. I think he's got some stuff already lined up in the future for a couple events. He's obviously done some Gfinity stuff. Maybe you'll see him at more DreamHack stuff down the line. So I feel like he's starting to finally find his place, which is great because he totally deserves it. He's an awesome dude, and I'm glad that he is finally getting events regularly, and I hope that continues for him. But I think Jackie is another guy that doesn't get a whole lot of stuff, but he was so awesome to work with. I mean, I think his play-by-play is really good. It's really hype. He flows with the words very well, but he's also really easy to work with as a color commentator. Like, he's always giving his color room to come in if they have insight or thoughts they want to add, you know, in the middle of the round if things are slow, or, you know, gives them plenty of time to recap things in the post-round or pre-round to bring things up that are irrelevant. And he trusts his co-caster, so, you know, he's in the middle of a round, he stops doing his play-by-play because maybe things have slowed down, or maybe he thinks that, you know, the people are setting up for something. He's going to give me a chance to come and talk about that. So he just kind of trusts his co-caster, you know, he just kind of passes them the line and says, here, take it if you want it, sort of deal. And so I would take it and add some insight when necessary, but it was also me, you know, keeping quiet, you know, if I didn't have anything or if I felt that what I had, you know, wasn't worth it. You know, and it was better for him just to kind of let there be a little bit of dead air and then come back in with the play-by-play for the real action. And so that was cool having that interaction with him and having that formula, which me and Metis have as well. But I think it was just more surprising how easy it was to do it with Jackie when I hadn't worked with him before, or at least I had worked with Metis a little bit. So that was really, really cool. And I think that's actually one of the best things I did this event was shut the fuck up, actually. There's been so many times where I ramble on too much, I'm not concise enough, or I talked too fast, and those things still did happen at this event. There were some times where I probably jug on a bit too long or I spoke a bit too fast. I'm going to be going back and watching through the VODs of all the matches I casted throughout this week, and as well as the death segment, so I'll try to pick up on some of that and improve, but I already know it's there. But no, like, I think I did do a little bit better this time around on just, like, letting my play-by-play continue rather than always interjecting. And it was really cool setting up with Jackie in this particular batch. And I think that's one of the biggest things I took away from it that I tried to put into use throughout the rest of the game. So I think sometimes, like I said, I did probably still go a bit overboard when I got excited about something or when I felt like I had something that was thought-provoking, but maybe I could have made it even more concise, right? So yeah, Jackie, really hope this guy gets some more work because he's definitely a talented play-by-play and he's very easy to work with and he knows how to use his color commentator. And that's a big thing. Like, you can be a great play-by-play caster, but if you don't know how to work with someone else, then maybe, you know, you're just overbearing. But not this guy. You know, excellent dude. Same with Metis, of course. So that was day one in the books. I felt the second game I had done with Optic and Hellraisers went better than the first one. So I started getting a little bit of confidence again, and was ready to go for the next day. So day two opened up with Splice versus Optic, which was another 2-1 series where Optic kind of wrecked the first map on Mirage. We had a close game on Train on map 2 that Splice actually won. And then we had Optic just kind of destroy them out there on Cobble. I did this game with Jackie, if I'm not mistaken, once more. And again, just excellent working with him. Again, I feel like I was starting to kind of get into the groove of things at this point. And it was definitely, you know, just again, another fun broadcast to do, catching a couple of NA teams go head-to-head. And then to end day two for me personally, I did the VP versus Hellraisers game, which was to determine who would get first seed in that group. And it was a 2-0 for Hellraisers. Pretty good games. Mirage was actually a really close one, a 14-16 game. So we got like a nice little, you know, intense game there. And then Cobble being close for a bit in the first half. And then like Hellraisers eventually just kind of like picked it up and never looked back. And I did that cast with Metis once more. So worked with Jackie twice and then I wound up working with Metis twice throughout the group stages. And it was excellent working with both of them. And yeah, definitely had a blast doing all of it. And then my last broadcast as far as being a commentator actually came on day three, where I did a best of five for the semifinals, Reverse Pro Play Temple Storm, and what a series this was. It's one of the few best of fives in CSGO that have gone all five maps, so that's kind of a cool little piece of history in itself to be a part of that. Once again, I'm here with Metis. And the way the series went was Tempo Storm kind of dominated the first two games on Dust2 and Train, but then Virtus Pro respond by just absolutely crushing them on Inferno. Then we had this close game on Cash where we thought, oh, maybe, you know, Tempo Storm's actually going to 3-1 the series, but it didn't happen. VP take it. They force a map 5 on Mirage, where Tempo Storm have a big CT side. It looked like they were just going to dominate the game, but they chuckled the close a bit there. They do wind up getting that game 5 win on Mirage, and they move on to the grand finals to play SK. And I think that this might have been one of the best casts I've done. It just felt right. You know, me and Meta seemed to be really clicking together. I don't know actually how my performance was. Again, I need to go back and listen to this best of five. This is actually the first series I want to go back and listen to because I think it'll give me a great idea about my stamina in the sense that how is my casting in map one compared to my casting in map five? Did I drop off? Did I start losing it? Did I start, you know, getting worse with my transitions? Did I lose energy? Things like that. I think that this will be a really good series for me to go back and review and try to figure out some things I need to work on. But it felt so good. I mean, I had already casted a bunch of series with Metis and Jackie leading up to this as well. So, again, you're getting into the groove of things. You're starting to flow better. It feels more natural at this point now. You're used to production being in your ear again because they've been doing it to you all week. So now that doesn't faze you as much anymore. And, yeah, I mean, it was awesome. And this is where I started to gain a little bit of respect from the other staff members, I felt like. Like, Puckett put out a tweet at the end of this, you know, just talking about, you know, great job to Medicine Dust for keeping up the energy and having a quality cast for 6 hours straight in this best of five and how cool it was. And that was awesome to hear. I mean, this is an industry leader. I mean, this dude is massive. You know, he's very versatile talent when it comes to hosting and interviewing and play-by-play casting, all these things that he's done for different games throughout his career. And to be able to kind of get some props from a guy like that, I mean, it's one thing for him to come up to me and say, great job, you know, nice job, shake your hand, all that good stuff, which that feels good as well, which happened a lot throughout the week with different people coming up and telling me that in person. And it always feels good. But then to go out of your way and give a public endorsement on social media is like taking that next step where this dude does have a massive following. And it, like, you have no idea how much that does for me, like how many followers I now get because he went out and said that. Or, you know, the fact that my name's out there with a bunch of people favoriting and retweeting, like that shit blows up. Like a big following guy like that can have a massive impact on a smaller guy like me. So for him to go out of his way and do that was awesome, and I appreciate that so much. And this is where I really started to get, like, a lot of tweets coming at me with people just saying, dog, you're doing a great job and all this stuff. And I have just never had that amount of positive messages coming that my way. Like, this is the first time I opened up my phone, opened up Twitter, and I had, like, 20 and then, like, a plus for the notifications tab because it was over, like, 20 notifications or something. I never had that happen before. And so, yeah, like, at this point, the positive response was just kind of overwhelming from the community, as well as, you know, getting some props from some of the big names that were there. So this was a really cool series, definitely one that I'll cherish, you know, memories that won't go away for sure, but with this particular best of five. And, yeah, it was just an awesome day. And then at this point, I thought that my event actually might be over because I was pretty sure I wasn't going to be casting the grand finals, which is totally fine. I had already done way more than I thought I was going to be able to do. Like, I casted several games in the group stages. You know, I think everyone casted about an equal amount when it came to the group stage. And I got to cast the semifinal, which is something I never really gotten to do, you know, at a bigger event. And I get that this event wasn't massive, but it still is two top teams in the world. Like, VP was a clear top 10 team in the world at this point. And then Tempo Storm, now they've proven that they're a top 10 team in the world. And they were playing against each other in a best of five. So, I mean, while maybe the overall tournament wasn't like this crazy tier one event with millions of dollars on the line with all the top teams involved, this particular best of five was two top teams with, you know, big implications. And it was a grinding battle that went all five games. And I think at one point we had like over 120 people watching on the main Twitch channel. And I'm not sure, you know where the numbers were at on like some of the other languages channels or something like that, but that's the most people I've ever casted in front of ever, and it was just crazy to do that. You know, it felt awesome. And like I again, I'll just never forget it for that reason, that it was like the biggest game I've ever casted in my entire career. So yeah, I mean, I could go on and on about just that alone, but I don't want to make this video drag on too long, and I want to wrap it up here, try to make this under 25 minutes. But anyway, so I thought my event might be over, and it turns out that no, they're going to rotate me in on the desk for the fourth day. So I'm finally going to get on the analysis desk. This is something I've wanted to do for so long. I had done it a little bit at a CEVO event, like season 6. This was back in like April of 2015, like a long time ago, over a year ago. But it was this really small event with only like 4 to 6 North American teams. They were all North American teams. And so it was just a smaller thing. And it wasn't even like a real analyst desk where we had like a host and a couple analysts. I think it was just me and another guy just talking to each other in between maps. So it was like very different. So this was my first time on like a real analyst desk, I guess I should say. Or analysis desk. I'm not sure how you're supposed to say it. Whatever. Anyway, so I found out I was going to get rotated on the desk, and like obviously I was prepared to do it. Like I said, I talked a little bit about all the research I had done, notes I had, yada, yada, yada. But, you know, to actually sit up there and do it was different. And so I came in on the desk for map 2 in the best of 5 here. This is a 3-1 series for Tempo Storm. And it was after map 1 had already happened, where I think Tempo Storm had just like destroyed VP on cash, which was out of left field type situation. And so I came in to do the like the preview for map 2, which was going to be Dust 2, which turned out to be an overtime game, 19-17, the only overtime game of the entire tournament. And then I did like the recap of Dust 2 and like a little bit of preview for map 3 Mirage before they rotated Launders in. As of course, they had Ryu on for map 1, which I thought he also did a pretty cool job. Also a cool dude, by the way, that I met and talked to quite a lot. I mean, I had also talked to, like, Uber and some of the other Selfless guys throughout the event, which, again, all of those guys really cool. Talked to Tempo Storm and SK guys a bit. Again, stand-up gentlemen. But, yeah, Ryu was, like, one of the guys I think I talked to the most outside of, like, the talent and the staff. And, yeah, just extremely nice dude, great guy. Wish him all the best with Selfless. But getting back to this point, you know, I didn't know what to expect, right? Because, yeah, I've chatted with Shalus and Thorin. Yeah, they've been really nice to me. But this is, like, different, right? Like, this is me working with them on a desk. These guys are, like, legends when it comes to the desk. I am just, a minnow in the pond, so to speak. And so it was really cool to get up there and work with them. I tried my best to be concise, but I think there were some moments where I went a bit too far with the information, like giving maybe a bit too much. But I also knew this was like my only chance to be on a desk, so like I guess I felt like I really needed to kill it. I really needed to prove that I knew what the fuck I was talking about and that I had all this knowledge. I had to like show it, you know, because it's just like trying to, you know, put me like on display, so to speak, right? And so I felt like that's probably why I, like, if I was doing a desk for an entire event and I knew that I was going to be on for multiple segments, I think I would have been a lot more concise. But because this was the only time I was going to do it, and I don't even know if it'll ever happen again, right? So it's like, I just want to go out there and nail it. And I also did talk probably way too fast. This is where I really noticed, like, I need to slow down. It's probably happened in this vlog a couple of times as well, though I haven't really been consciously thinking about it. But the next time that I'm casting or doing a desk, I'm definitely going to go into it, you know, thinking, all right, slow down. So I definitely had some things to work on, but the experience itself was phenomenal, and it was really awesome working with those guys. Yeah, I know this is going to be like an abrupt break, but I'm going to come back to this desk segment here in my conclusion. So to conclude, I just wanted to say that I had a great time, and I want to definitely thank the guys over at CEVO and Gfinity for giving me this opportunity, especially guys like Michael Brown over at Gfinity, who even like agreed with people and helped me get on the desk, and just, you know, putting trust in someone who hasn't done an event for a very long time. And giving me the opportunity. So I got to give big props to CEVO and Gfinity and all those guys over there for helping me get opportunities. Also have to thank Richard Lewis and Thorin, who were supportive of me going onto the desk and helping in that regard. People may not know that. People may just think, oh, the director threw him up there. But no, like, you know, Richard and Thorin embraced the idea, were completely supportive of it, and were happy to give me an opportunity to do it. So I got to thank those guys as well, as well as all the casters who worked with me. And, you know, gave me some insight, gave me some pointers, as well as just were, again, very supportive of giving me room to work with and just being awesome people. Also got to give big thanks to the community itself. Again, I've never had this much positive response on social media ever. You know, just my feed blowing up on Twitter with kind words and, you know, all that good stuff was great. Also the most followers I've ever gained in any event. I think I gained like over 200 people throughout the 4 days of casting at this event on Twitter. Never had that kind of growth before from just one event. So again, I got to thank all of you for that. This was especially after I did the semifinals cast that I talked about with Metis and the death segments. I mean, that's when my stuff really blew up. And that's going to transition back to this death segment with Richard Lewis and Thorne, was that these guys publicly endorsed me on Twitter, kind of like how Puckett had done during the semifinals. You know, Thorne's going out here saying that, you know, under the right circumstances that, you know, I could be doing analysis desk work in the future, that he could see me doing that, and he liked it. You know, Richard Lewis is, like, retweeting that tweet, and then he's putting out his own tweet saying, you know, these guys often go unappreciated, and he named me on that list. And then he also made some tweet about, like, what if these guys had a board, like, how great they would look if they were able to, like, draw on the map and point things out. We should, you know, make that happen more regularly. You know, just positive things to say, basically. And again, like, it's one thing to go up to someone behind the scenes and, like, shake their hand, tell them they did a good job. But then it's another when you know that you have a big following, or maybe you don't even consciously think that you have a big following when you're doing it, but you do have a big following, that is true, and then you're going out here and you're publicly kind of endorsing someone. I mean, that's just incredible. And again, when these guys went out there and did that, my feed just blew up even more, and it's like more people like noticing me and stuff like that. And I'll be forever indebted to those two guys, Thorne and Richard Lewis, for just, you know, understanding that I really wanted to do this desk thing and like supporting that, and then after having done it, like giving me props. I mean, I think that this does wonders for my confidence. Like, it's one thing to get positive support from, you know, fans, but to earn the respect of, like, industry leaders, people that I look up to, you know, people that I use as maybe inspiration, that's something special to me that, you know, I'll hold to my heart. So try not to get emotional here, because I did at the event with those guys, so I need to keep it down here. But anyway, that's, like, actually my biggest takeaway from the event was what was being able to kind of just get the respect of people that I had so much respected. And I can go on and on about this as well, but I don't want to make this video last forever. So, yeah, definitely, once again, just awesome, all the people that I work with throughout this event. I think I've named each of them, but if I forgot someone, I'm so sorry. But everyone was definitely great to me, and I appreciate it. As of now, I'm not sure what's going to happen next for me. I don't have anything lined up quite yet, but I'm hopeful that maybe, thanks to the help of these guys, that maybe I will get some more stuff. I know that, aside from the public endorsement, I know that Richard said he was going to try to go up to bat for me for some things behind the scenes. So, again, in debt to that guy, what a fantastic gentleman that he is, as well as Thorin, to try to help and see if they can't get me some more gigs in the future. And, again, that just further builds up my confidence, because you have to understand that, you know, I actually don't have the thick skin that people need to have in this industry sometimes. I've really let the people shitting on me get to me at times. I'm starting to get better with that. I think this event will help more as well. But, you know, it's awesome these guys would go out there and do that for me, because it definitely helps me feel better about things. Also, just to, you know, wrap this thing up, I do plan on doing more content about the matches and stuff themselves. I think I'll be putting out an article on Splice sometime this week about storylines from the finals. I also am trying to work out doing an interview with Peacemaker from Tempo Storm on an episode of my old talk show, The Hype, that I haven't done in a very long time. I'm trying to see if maybe I can't start bringing that back and do that a little bit more regularly. I know people used to like it in the past. Maybe a lot of people now don't even know what the hell it is, because I haven't done it in so long. But I'm trying to see if I can't get some interviews back in the NA scene with The Hype. And I think I'm going to try to contact with Peacemaker from Tempo Storm. I know he's down to do the interview, so it's going to happen at some point. I just don't know if I'm going to have time to do it about this event before DreamHack Austin starts, because they only get a couple of days of downtime before they have to travel to the next event. So there may not be time, but hopefully at some point this month, even if I can't do it before Austin, I'll be able to get an interview with Peacemaker from Tempo Storm. So definitely have that planned as well, as I'm sure I'll be doing more videos or articles revolving around DreamHack Austin and the minor and things like that, because there's a lot going on in North America here in the next few weeks when it comes to events. So I'll be looking to produce content around all of that. And other than that, just stay tuned. If you enjoy stuff here, just follow up, subscribe, and look out for more stuff. And again, thanks so much to everyone. See you next time.